When people think of the scientific detection of evidence of alien life, a lot of people think of radio telescopes picking up signals from huge beacons that pulse out prime numbers or some other unambiguous broadcast. And for a long time, looking for that was essentially the only game in town regarding the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. But recent improvements in technology have opened up multiple new avenues for detecting alien life and civilizations independent of radio, greatly improving our chances of actually picking something up. So here are 10 ways we might potentially detect alien life other than radio signals. Number 10. Altered atmospheres. It's no secret that life dramatically affects Earth as a planet, from its geology to its atmospheric composition. But perhaps most markedly from a distance is the oxygenation of the atmosphere through photosynthesis. Without the plants, our atmosphere would look radically different and we wouldn't be here. But other gases actively being created by life on this world also include methane and, of course, carbon dioxide, which you are exhaling as you watch this video. This makes Earth's atmosphere unusual, to say the least. As we begin the detailed study of exoplanet atmospheres as our instrumentation improves, it could be that we see a planet with a similarly odd mix of gases. While natural processes can produce these gases without life, when you see the right mix, so to speak, such as with Earth, then biology being the origin for that mix becomes the simplest explanation. But knowing what that life is really like would be very difficult to determine, other than perhaps being able to reasonably conclude certain things, such as exoplanet photosynthesis creating oxygen. But there's also a chance that we might see gases that are not likely to come from nature, but instead from technology. One of these are CFCs, and if we detected those in the spectrum of an exoplanet atmosphere, we would know that there was a technological civilization there, perhaps in the process of destroying their ozone layer. Also, here is the possibility of an atmospheric curveball. We might also see exoplanets with very unlikely atmospheric compositions, suggesting that someone had terraformed those worlds and assembled a custom atmosphere for whatever purpose they had in mind. Perhaps a machine civilization might get rid of their old, reactive, biological oxygen atmosphere entirely and replace it with an unnaturally pure, inert gas. Number 9. City lights. Radio emissions aren't the only type of electromagnetic radiation that human civilization produces that alien scientists might see if they were studying this planet looking for unambiguous signs of a civilization. Another would be our artificial lighting on the night side of our world. With sufficiently sensitive equipment, our city lights would stick out like a sore thumb in a spectrum as purely technological in nature. Likewise, it might be reasonable to expect that aliens might also light up the dark sides of their worlds with similar technological lighting. This is not yet a feasible technosignature for SETI to look for. Our current instruments wouldn't pick up Earth lighting much past our own Oort cloud, but future instruments might be able to perform such a search. One speculative variant, however, might be significantly easier to spot. If an alien civilization decided to use the light of their star to create daylight conditions on the dark side of their world using orbital mirrors, that arrangement might be currently visible in a light curve as the planet transits its star. Number 8. Alien waste heat. One thing that's thought to be likely for any advancing civilization is that they will generate increasing amounts of heat as they consume increasing amounts of energy. This is true of all alien technologies that we can envision, whether it's a Dyson swarm or an ecumenopolis planet. Waste heat thusly would be detectable to us as infrared radiation. The problem with detecting these sorts of emissions is that nature also produces lots and lots of infrared radiation. For example, young stars still surrounded by protoplanetary disks radiate brightly in infrared as the material in orbit absorbs solar energy and then re-radiates it as heat. However, there are ways to distinguish natural from artificially produced infrared. For example, if one found a galaxy that emits a lot of infrared but little or no visible light, then this would be a good indicator that a Kardashev Type 3 civilization has encased the galaxy's stars inside Dyson spheres, if such a thing is possible. And in fact, searches for this have been made, though so far, nothing has been found. Number 7. Laser emissions. In addition to radio, SETI began some time ago to look also for laser emissions emanating from star systems, known typically as optical SETI. This makes sense. Laser light is very recognizable as technological in nature, and laser also happens to be really useful in communications. It's also useful in things like space-based propulsion, scientific measurement, and many other areas. Once again, if we find this sort of thing useful, a technological alien civilization might also, so it's at least worthwhile to search for evidence of alien laser communications. The problem with laser SETI, however, is that it's very directional, meaning that the laser would have to be pointed at us, either intentionally as a beacon, or accidentally, as in a detection of alien internal communications, or leakage from a light sail, or some other purpose that happens to be pulsed or emitted in such a way that it can be detected and verified. You'd be right if you were to say that it's a long shot that we would detect intentional alien laser emissions. In order to point a laser at Earth and start sending pulsed communications, the alien civilization would have to know that we're here. They might do this if they suspected that Earth might be inhabited, and our atmospheric composition has given away life's existence here for some time. But it's unlikely that anyone could know about our civilization much further out than about 80 light years. And even then, our own emissions to date would be very difficult to detect. In short, if they don't know about us, they probably wouldn't put the energy into a laser beacon to contact us. But say they did. Just such a detection would be far less ambiguous than what's possible with radio. The reason for this is that radio is plagued by two issues. One is the abundance of natural radio that lots of things in the universe emit. If you turn a radio telescope towards space, you will hear bizarre, difficult-to-explain signals. But you can't say they are of alien origin unless they are absolutely unambiguous. All you can say is that you saw a weird signal, as is the case for the WOW signal. The other issue is our own radio interference, which complicates things further. We produce a ton of radio emissions, and it's not always easy telling the difference between a signal coming from afar or one originating from Earth. With laser, these concerns are less of a problem. Number 6. Alien artifacts. This one is an outright trope within science fiction. Over the decades, many stories have been written about humans finding some kind of an alien artifact. These include Clark and Kubrick's monolith, the various Prothean artifacts from Mass Effect, and my own personal favorite, the 20-million-year-old ship frozen in the Arctic ice from John W. Campbell's novella, Who Goes There, the film adaptation of which was John Carpenter's The Thing. But in reality, it actually is plausible that at some point, we may run into some kind of an alien artifact in our solar system. This could take many forms, and in fact, if we did find one, it may not be what we expect. Instead of a monolith or von Neumann probe, it could simply come in the form of an asteroid that, at some point in the distant past, had been mined by aliens passing through, leaving it mysteriously exhausted of certain materials. Another might be an accidental artifact, perhaps a dead probe sent out by aliens for scientific exploration, that just happened to enter the solar system just as some of our probes, such as Voyager 2, might someday, millions of years from now, pass through someone else's star system long after they ceased their original mission and stopped functioning. Another possibility is seeing artifacts from a distance. Perhaps the remains of a spacefaring civilization might be detected through infrared emissions, such as a Dyson swarm, but with no evidence that the civilization is still active. And of course, there's always the possibility of an intentional artifact. A kind of self-replicating or repairing Rosetta Stone sent out by a civilization wishing to announce its presence to others by planting physical messages in all star systems in the galaxy that seem suitable to eventually develop life. Number 5. Satellites and orbital rainbow telescopes. These two concepts are relative newcomers to the field of technosignatures. The first is that extensive geostationary alien satellite networks might be visible in light curves as they transit across the face of their star. Satellites should be distinguishable from natural ring systems by their overall geometry, as satellites would form more of a belt rather than a disk as a natural ring system typically would do. The other possibility here is an orbital telescope. This one has not yet been well fleshed out, but the idea of such a thing was put forth by Marco Quadrelli and colleagues at JPL, link below. Known as orbiting rainbows, the idea was to create an extremely large telescope in space by using the optical properties of particulate matter spread out over a large distance, much like droplets of water bend light to form rainbows. While this is in itself an interesting idea for us to do here on Earth, a way to build a true megatelescope straightforwardly, alien telescopes could also be feasibly built, and if so, such a structure might be visible in the light curves of stars with exoplanets. Though it might ultimately prove to be difficult to distinguish from ordinary dust. Number 4. Arnold Louvers. Perhaps the biggest problem with announcing your presence to the rest of the universe is that while there are many methods for doing so, particularly radio, most would be very energy intensive, which is made particularly unattractive when you have no idea if you'll ever get a response to your signal. But what of more passive ways to announce your existence? What of methods that are useful in more ways than just saying hello? In 2005, astronomer Luke Arnold suggested in a paper, link below, a way of sending a message simply by having an unnaturally shaped object transit in front of a star. Any civilizations studying stellar astronomy might then see the weird geometric dip in light caused by the transit of a shaped solid object, such as a set of louvers, that would not likely exist in nature. Then that civilization would know that what they were seeing in the light curve was of alien origin. The beauty of this approach is that such a megastructure in orbit of a star could be dual use, such as being both a visual beacon to other civilizations, but also a massive orbital habitat or energy collector. The aliens could then have their exocake and eat it too. Number 3. Unlikely movement. One thing that can virtually be said for sure is that the universe changes and presents situations where it might be advantageous or even critical for a civilization to move their own planet or even their own star. Hypothetical technologies to do this range from gravitationally migrating planets using asteroid passes over very long periods of time, something we may well do with Earth long term to avoid the effects of the eventual swelling of the sun into a red giant. Eventually, through this method, very unnatural-looking star systems could be designed, or, over millions of years of astronomical observation, a planet might be spotted that is being migrated to a different orbit unnaturally, or even a star might be seen moving. Enormous Shkadov thrusters might be spotted in light curves, where partial Dyson spheres built nearby to stars allow them to thrust themselves into different areas of the galaxy. Number 2. Star tickling. One of the biggest issues with radio SETI is that if you really want to tell the universe in general that you exist, you must essentially beam out a very powerful omnidirectional, or nearly so, signal for a very long time to have any hope of success. In other words, it would be among the most expensive things an alien civilization could do. But there is an alternative. There are objects in this universe that already do all of the above, and if you could tweak them into somehow behaving unnaturally, then you've got yourself a more economical beacon. Of particular interest here are the variable stars. The idea is that if you could bombard a Cepheid variable star with neutrinos, you might be able to make it pulse unnaturally, perhaps pulsing out prime numbers or some other mathematical message that shouldn't occur in nature. The beauty of this approach is that, while fairly cheap to set up, it's also fairly easy to spot. A lot of data has been taken by astronomers on variable stars over the years, and much more will come. Meaning that to search for such signals, one would merely need to look through data already being taken anyway for variable star study. Number 1. The unknown signal. Ultimately, nothing says that we currently possess the technology to even intercept an alien communication at all. Maybe they use none of the above methods, and simply put, we don't know everything about the universe, and essentially nothing about advanced alien civilizations. We do not yet have a full understanding of our universe, and can only guess about the technologies that it allows. Because of this, within SETI there are hypothetical ideas of signals that highly advanced alien civilizations might produce that we can't intercept yet, such as using neutrinos or gravity to communicate, if that's even possible. As a result, the galaxy could be teeming with alien communications that we simply do not have the science and tech yet to be able to receive, and someday, if we do come upon technologies like that, we might just find that the universe is indeed full of intelligent alien life. We merely just didn't know how to see them. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently reminding the interested that I'll be on Open Space with Fraser Cain over on his channel later today at 5 p.m. Pacific, 8 p.m. Eastern, where we'll take questions and talk about space, science fiction, or whatever you want. Literally, I'll talk about exomusks, toast, or octopus intelligence, or just about anything if prodded. See you there, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.